Thank you, panel, for your presentations. I think my question would be directed to almost all of you. To what level of convincing do probably these national institutions need to say biodiversity conservation is very vital to the economy and the people within it? Looking at the fact that I would applaud Rwanda, which presented me the statistic to say this is the certain amount that goes to community from the ecotourism. But in most cases, you find that the money from the ecotourism never benefits the community. You know, so to what level of convincing do we have to, you know, do to have funding for these environmental projects or environmental conservation projects on biodiversity? Because funding for those is really, really difficult in some countries.
Yeah, thank you. You know, the question just that what the panel said. In general, when we talk about biodiversity here, people think about...
You can introduce yourself.
Oh, okay. I'm Michel Masozero, and I work for Worldwide Fund for Nature. I'm the deputy water practice leader for Africa. So, back to my comment is, when people talk about biodiversity here in Rwanda, we tend to think about chimpanzees in Nyungwe, mountain gorillas in the volcanoes, and golden monkeys in the Mukura, Ishwati. But in terms of benefits to local livelihoods, think about pollinators. Our agriculture production, to produce food, we need pollinators. And that's a gap in the knowledge we have in our biodiversity system. We have collected data in many protected areas, but when you think about agricultural landscapes or outside protected area, we don't put much attention to that, but that's food production is very important. And food sustains livelihood of thousands of or millions of Rwandans, and their livelihood depend on that. So when we think about the importance and the impact of biodiversity to local and national economy, we have to think about those assets that are not under our radars. And it's linked to the biases Professor Peterson said. We have taxonomic biases and geographic biases in the way we do our biodiversity boundaries.
Thank you, Dr. Kanyamuga. Also, I believe that it also is a challenge about pollinators because of spraying and insects, like, so we can already put it down as one of the challenges. Yes, Sam.
Well, thank you very much, Dennis. And my apologies, I came late. I went to another meeting about the celebrations for the World Ozone Layer today. My name is Sam Kanyamigwa, Executive Director, Albert and Rift Conservation Society, ARCOS. I just want to share my thoughts on some of the challenges. I have been involved in the biodiversity information management for over 20 years, and I really appreciate the comments from the SDGs Center in terms of institutional ownership and the mechanism. Which is very important. I used to work for a UNEP center coordinating biodiversity data, and I was the head of Africa, and I know how it was really challenging to get accurate information owned by the country. That was where it was working. It was because of a very good national institution. But I want to come back to when you say about biodiversity data. I think one of the problems we have is also the simplification. We live in a society attracted by economic development, social aspects. And when we talk about biodiversity here, we always talk about biodiversity as biodiversity, taxa, plants, mammals, and in this language, doesn't really necessarily easily pass. It is very difficult to get it. And so there are challenges of having this information available, accessible, used, and you can see that even where this biodiversity data is available, is not either accessible or used. Town shared information about data we have in Rwanda, dominated by birds. You can even wonder if the data we have on birds is used, is accessible. Is this the case? So that is the scenario we are looking at. But also, when you are looking at biodiversity or birds or data alone is not enough. That's why we have to integrate this data with other socio-economic aspects. We need to collect integrated data. How is data changing in relation to socio-economic context? Because everything is linked. How biodiversity is changing, affecting the socio-economic conditions. And in our course, we have been collecting data on integrated landscape, collecting integrated landscape assessment in some of the landscapes. And some data you have seen on the portal that Tom referred to, we are now with the GRS trying to upgrade the portal so that can integrate these aspects. So to me, it is really important that we put biodiversity data in the context, because no decision maker, no users is going to look at data in isolation. If it look at data in isolation, it will not be meaningful for the socio-economic context, which is more pressing, more direct, and this is the life we are facing today.
Thank you very much. So I hear that we shouldn't forget the socio-economic context or impacts. We tend to look at ecosystem categories of biodiversity, but we should consider species and the genetic diversity. I know there's a lot of information out there, but in the informatics development or information system, I think we have to include that. Anyone behind from behind this slide? Yes. And then we can move back to the panel.
Thank you, panelists. I'm Patience from Makere University, Uganda. I'd like to appreciate what the panelists said, especially regarding the xenoplants. However, one challenge has been standardization of dosages. So I'd like to know how maybe national institutions here are trying to help the different herbal associations achieve standardization.
Thank you very much. So perhaps we should move from having had those challenges back to the panel and to see what the government in Rwanda in terms of programs to address some of these challenges, absolutely this again from government.
Thank you very much, moderator. In terms, maybe for the last question, yes, on standardized, how can we help the associations? There are some current work with institution in charge of industrial research, which also work on phytomedicine, so they are trying to help those associations. We need to look at their products, to look at the standards and to develop their capacity. So there are many initiatives in that line, so that really the products are products that are up to the standards to be used. Coming back to there is also a question which was very interesting on how we are convincing, you know, policymakers, especially those that provide funding, to develop projects for protection of environment versus biodiversity. Yes, it's really very important. We have an issue to point. It's because the degradation of biodiversity ecosystem services, you know, the consequences, you know, they are visible on a long term. So when you can notice them, sometimes it is too late. So what we have been doing in Rwanda, and there are two cases that are really very meaningful, which brought the government to understand the importance of biodiversity and ecosystem services. It was one wetlands that was very degraded, and it was feeding in a lake that is where we have a hydropower plant. And when it was really degraded, we experienced shortage of electricity in Rwanda, and it was impacting the economy. So the Rwanda Environment Management Authority used this case to raise the flag of importance of biodiversity ecosystem services. We noticed that at that time, the government has to use generators that were costing 65,000 US dollars per day for diesel. You see, so when we raised this flag, and this figure, you know, brought the Ministry of Environment, or the Ministry of Planning and Budget to understand the importance of, you know, the biodiversity ecosystem services. Another case was the forest they were talking about, which has been now allocated as approved as a new park, Ishwati Forest in Mukura. It was degraded because of, relocating refugees, etc. And it is a hilly, in a hilly area. It was protecting, you know, the hills. And after the destruction, degradation, we have, and with impacts of changing climates, floods, disrupting, you know, disrupting agriculture products, you know, claiming lives of people, disrupting like tarmac roads, and we use also this really to raise the flag of the environment. And this is how we get budget to develop project of environmental protection. So coming back quickly to the question of, the most pressing challenges, I think we have been talking about that, especially unsustainable land around natural resource management. We talk about the use of land, the use of water, aquatic ecosystems. I'm talking about forest degradation. I'm talking about wetlands. So really, these are most pressing challenges in our country to look at how can we really use our natural resources sustainably. You understand the consequences of unsustainable management of those resources. It means soil erosion, impacting water resources, sedimentation, impacting soil fertility and then agriculture, impacting also biodiversity, because we have fragmentation of habitat. So there are so many consequences of unsustainable land use or sustainable natural resource use. We have also the issues now of climate change. It's really, in Rwanda, we are living the impacts of climate change. We have also the issues of pollution that are really developing with the industrial development of the country. And we really need also to tackle those issues of soil, water, and air pollution, because it impacts also biodiversity.
So also the local government still in terms of what programs to replace some of the challenges you have had, or you have noted yourself supporting.
Okay, yeah, thank you Natl for laying that foundation. I think the challenges that she just mentioned, climate change for instance, the government has a number of programs to try and redress this, starting from the policy development, but also to more applicable, if I can borrow that word, applicable strategies, including the SPCR, or the Strategic Program for Climate Resilience, and the Forest Investment Plan. That this is a way of packaging interventions that the government or government institutions and its partners can come into the space of mitigating climate change or adapting to climate change as a way of redressing the problem. So I guess guess what I'm trying to put across is we shouldn't look at biodiversity as a standalone. We are looking at it as part of the environment, an integral part of the environment, which is first being attacked by different challenges. So in so doing, we are not talking about biodiversity alone, but when we talk about ecosystem restoration or restoration of degraded ecosystems, biodiversity is at the heart of it all. When we restore these ecosystem habitats, we are indirectly or directly responding to the challenge. We also have a challenge of wetland degradation. Improper use of wetlands, illegal use of wetlands. Luckily, government has allocated our wetlands as protected areas, and their use has to be